just wanted to take this moment to say that we at the Resistance are still fighting. We will not stop until we take America back. What was that? Oh, we already got America. Well, now I just feel silly.
Yeah, it's weird.
Then this is The Enthusiast, and it's time to start the podcast.
Yes! Oh my God!
What is up, everybody? I am one of your hosts, Will Szabo. Alongside me, Jesse Nazario.
Hello, sir. How are you doing?
Pretty good. How about you?
Not doing great, man. Not doing great.
2 weeks ago, I met the love of my life at a voice panel, Comic-Con. I'm not going to say his name, Jonathan Silver. But he hasn't called. He hasn't wrote. I don't know if he's listening to the podcast. So... Jonathan, I understand about the restraining order, man. I do. Just want to hang out, man. Be bros, that's all. Be a bro love, that's it, you know. Got a man crush, that's all, Jonathan. So, DM me, that's all I'm saying. Is that wrong? Is it wrong to want to get DM'd?
Maybe, a little.
I guess so.
But, you know.
I mean, you saw the chemistry between us.
I did. At first, it looked like he was a little awkward with you, though.
He did feel uncomfortable, but eventually he came around to the love me.
It's a little weird because, to be honest, he came around and it's almost like that stalker that never leaves, but you eventually get it.
Yeah.
That's what it feels like. It felt like a win for the weird kids.
You know what I mean? Like, I captured him in my enchanted castle and he eventually fell in love with me and, you know, all the different living furniture I had. Stockholm Syndrome.
Beauty and the Beast.
Yes, that's what I did there.
I like it. So, what did you do this week? How was it?
I played Call of Duty because I came out Friday. There was a midnight opening for it because apparently it is...
a big deal or something.
Yes, it's a big deal. There was actually a lot of people there to pick up Call of Duty, which shocked me because midnights are what they used to be at GameStop. What annoyed me, and I want to know your opinion on this, some certain cities and some areas are allowed to do 9 a.m. or 9 p.m. releases because of danger. I think that's unfair.
Oh, this is cool.
So because I don't live in a rough neighborhood, I get my game at 12.
Hey.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Is that fair? Am I being jaded?
I know what we got to do. Increase the crime rate.
That's what I'm saying. Do I have to stab a man or two? Is that what it takes at a midnight to be like, unsafe? I need my game at 9.
Might be worth it.
I take it. So, because if I'm not mistaken, if it comes out at midnight, it still gets released at midnight,
just
right?
Finished installing it to my
yes.
PC.
What about the people that are on Eastern Standard Time or all that? Do they get it at midnight too?
You mean Western? I mean Pacific.
So people, do we get it like 2 hours earlier than that?
No, I believe they get it at our time. I think it gets released worldwide for the U.S. at Eastern.
So they get it at 12, they get it at like 8.
I think so.
Because I remember when my wife was in Oklahoma, there was like a 4 hour difference between us. I was 4 hours ahead.
Uh-huh.
So that's what I'm saying. So they get it like technically 4 hours, you know, earlier than us.
Yeah.
Boom.
Short email addresses.
I'm sorry. I gotta look that in. I gotta inset. Words. I gotta look that up. I'm curious about that now.
So how are you feeling about the new Call of Duty?
I'm only playing the campaign, and I'm really liking it. Three reasons.
That you
Probably
have
four.
Member
go
addresses for
five
to join into
reasons.
Your party.
Josh Duhamel is really good in it.
Right. So let's
he
open
plays the
menu.
Dick in the game.
Only the dick.
Yes.
Not the balls.
He's the jerk commander you have in it. I really like him. And it's funny because he's always like that pretty boy in Hollywood.
Okay.
Yeah, real likable guy, and he's playing a jerk in this.
Oh.
I really do like that.
This is a
I do like
the
no regeneration health. Makes it feel a little more real. Now, granted, if somebody throws you a med kit and you take it for a second, you don't heal completely in real life, but at least it's a little more real than, you know, ducking and covering and health coming back.
Okay.
And I do really like the fact they kind of got rid of the arcadish feel in Call of Duty.
Okay. Okay.
Have you played campaign at all?
No, I've only been playing multiplayer.
See, I want to talk about the opening, but I can't because you're a jerk.
I know, I'm sorry. I've been playing Wolfenstein a lot.
I know, I saw you playing it when I got here. It's so good.
It is such a beautiful game.
Is that a picture of Hitler on the wall, huh?
Yeah, it is.
They don't shy away from that, huh?
No, in the game, not at my house.
That was a good point to bring up, just in case anybody was curious.
I just wanted to make sure you...
You have a picture of Stalin on your wall, not Hitler, man.
No.
No.
I don't.
Alright, no, seriously, though, I was really shocked, though, because I'm even shocked with this Call of Duty, because the show's not swastikas, and games kind of always kind of been afraid to show that.
Yeah.
They've always gotten away with doing different things.
They've kind of, like, taken a step back.
Yeah, even Marvel's Captain America, the first Avengers, they had that the two lines instead of showing any swastikas in that movie.
Yeah.
That was a Hollywood movie, for goodness sakes. Surprising, but yeah, even this Call of Duty shows swastikas, and that with the Wolfenstein, there's a big picture of Hitler on the wall, so I guess they have no issue.
Huge swastika banners.
So that game is if we lost the war, correct?
Yes.
So they came. So it takes place on U.S. soil.
Yep.
They just Germany controlled.
Yep.
Nazi Germany controlled.
Yep.
But Germany is not all Nazis, you know. But apparently, there's Nazis over in the U.S. too.
Awkward.
Yes.
But
I am very much enjoying Call of Duty. I think this is the first Call of Duty in a really long time that I'm glad I got it day one.
Okay.
Number two, I don't feel like I'm forcing my way through the story.
Okay. Like you, it's naturally enjoyable for you.
Just when I want to get up and play it, you know, that kind of idea. Like Infinity War, I didn't hate it like everybody else did, but that was kind of a chore to get through that campaign at certain points.
Yeah, the multiplayer is a bit of the same. It's fun. I'm enjoying it as of now. I usually enjoy Call of Duty multiplayer until I can't play for a while, and then when I happen to jump back into it, it feels like, oh, everyone has all this stuff that I don't have, and now I'm losing.
Yeah, that's why I don't really play online.
But I'm enjoying it so far.
How do you feel about the World War II? A setting. Do you think it's cool? Do you think it's interesting?
I like that we went back to it. I mean, I've always liked the classic guns more than, modern day guns. So it's nice to see, like, the M1 Grand make a return, the Kar-98K, and stuff like that. But other than that, like, a part of me wishes they would have chosen a different war, because while I do love World War II, I almost feel like we've been there, done that so many times. Even though we did have a really big gap without any World War II shooters, I think... I really liked Battlefield 1 because they went to World War 1, and it was just a different experience, you know what I mean? To get mustard gas and things like that.
Yeah, nobody does World War 1 except for Wonder Woman Battlefield. You know what I do appreciate it, though, is there is certain scenes in the game that were in previous Call of Duties. But the way the game's campaign works is like, this is, you play as one central character that somehow has been involved in all these... DJ things and taking to the hill and all that stuff. So I think it's cool how they put him in the story. But it is also like very Saving Private Ryan. Like it's a very gory, messy game. Like it's the first really violent Call of Duty I've seen. Most of them just have like blood sprays, but you know.
You see organs and things.
You see organs, people's legs getting hopped off, you know what I mean?
I can see that.
You remember being in Saving Private Ryan when he's dragging the dude and he looks back and it's just torso, that's it.
I like that, but my favorite one is the guy walking around looking for his arm.
And then he picks it up, puts it in his pocket. Yeah,
yeah. That's my favorite guy in that entire movie. I thought he was so funny. But
that's what it really reminds me of. Like, there's a lot of scenes like that. There's a scene where you're going through a village in the game, and you just see how deplorable the Nazis are, and they're just like body parts, hanging people, and just everywhere, just laid out. It's just a really graphic scene for a Call of Duty, and it's like, well, I'm glad you didn't shy away from it because it was still a very graphic war. You know, World War II was a very graphic war.
I would love for them to do Vietnam, and the song constantly be Unfortunate Son. And I want to be able to call in an airstrike for Agent Orange, where we just see it get poured all over the enemy.
I think the problem with Vietnam, and it's why that one game didn't sell well, I can't remember the name of it. It got released, and it was a World War II game, but it was a famous battle that we did not win in World War II. And the game didn't sell. And a lot of people chalked it up to that people want a happy experience at the end of it, not... Well, I know this soldier's not going to make it because his whole platoon got wiped out during it. You know what I mean? So maybe that's why they never really made a Vietnam game. Maybe. Also, the Vietnam War is still very...
Yeah. it wasn't a war. We never lost a war.
Okay. Calm down, America.
We have quite a bit to talk about, though. I think we're going to be on the news for a little while, so maybe we should get started with
the news. First up, you're coming out of the closet, man. Everybody's almost telling us something.
No.
Come on out of the closet, man.
No. Justice League.
Oh.
That's first.
I got my notes mixed up again. I'm sorry.
That's second.
Oh, my bad. That's embarrassing. So, China. I have always wanted to say it like that. I'm
Vietnam's
sorry.
Older brother.
Yes. how does our president say China? China. They got to look at the first 30 minutes of Justice League.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the reviews are coming out for it. We found an altar already. How's it looking over there?
Say it's good.
They're loving it. They're loving it. Now, I went and looked
it's up. Like McDonald's.
Yes, they're loving it. So far, every review I've seen early is giving the scene stealer to Ezra Miller or The Flash. I don't think either of us are shocked by that. He looked like he was going to be the
same. I called this.
Ben Affleck's apparently really good. Apparently, same thing, Wonder Woman. But what I've heard from every review is every star gets an opportunity, or every star and every character gets an opportunity to shine. So,
that's really good.
You know what I mean? I'm really excited because I was very afraid that Cyborg and Aquaman were going to kind of fall into the far back.
Because let's be honest, in the Avengers, I would say the ones that kind of fall short usually are Hawkeye.
Yep.
He never really gets much love. And I would say that in the first Avengers, it was Black Widow. Because, you know, she didn't really have power. So I feel like her and Hawkeye were that. But I felt like her fan base really grew after the first Avengers movie. And then they fixed that in Avengers 2.
Yeah.
But...
They're the only ones that really didn't like it. And especially in the first one, they didn't have those, like, side storylines like the rest of them. And like you said, they're trying to fix it too by introducing Hawkeye with his family and everything. But even then, he never really felt like he shined out. So I agree, there's always that character that has to fall to the far. But I don't know, I think it's going to be good. I'm hoping it's good.
I'm happy to hear, though, that everyone's doing, you know, and I'm glad that not all the news that came out was about Ben Affleck's Batman again. Because it shows that, like, oh man, these other characters can be just as cool and popular.
I do really... Okay, so they also came out with an announcement that the whole Stephen Wolf is the nephew, not the uncle. It's not true. He is still the uncle.
Oh.
Okay, so he's apparently existed forever.
All right.
And his whole going to Earth is to try to overthrow Darkseid. So that's the central plot around this. I'm actually really excited about that. That he hates Darkseid, but he's so much more powerful than him. So I think the whole idea, this is just a theory, but I know it is so he can overthrow him. So I think he's probably going to try to turn Earth into another version of Apocalypse.
For himself.
For himself, kind of thing. I'm looking really forward to it. I love everything I've seen from him in the trailer.
Yeah.
I told you last time that line in the trailer where the guy's like, we have families. Why does everybody keep saying that?
Yeah.
Like, why would I care? I'm still going to kill you.
So, yeah.
Really excited for him. Really excited.
You know, it's funny because Ezra Miller stole basically the movie from me just in trailers, so I can only imagine he thinks he's going to do the movie.
I did really get excited that Batman v Superman. The Lex Luthor has that famous line where he's like, you know, that painting's a lie. We now know that devils come from the sky. And then the first scene of Stephen Wolf they show in the trailer is him coming down from the sky. I don't know if they did it on purpose, but I was like,
yeah,
go ahead, DC.
So here's some food for thought, though. We are getting some really good reviews from China.
Mm-hmm.
But the Chinese also like things like Transformers.
Yes.
They do like some pretty horrible movies.
Pacific Rim, they love Pacific Rim too. They like their big explosions.
They're really into action.
And they like their big American blockbusters.
Correct? Yes. So it's kind of hard to really know, should we really be believing that... Should we be getting excited for Justice League to be a really good
movie?
As
me and you, DC fanboys... And I feel like anybody that's a fanboy DC, yeah. Do I still think this movie's going to be attacked? Absolutely.
There's no way it could be attacked. I mean, let's be honest. After what Thor Ragnarok's been getting, there's no way Marvel fans can be like, hey, Marvel, you're still doing great.
Yeah.
And DC, you finally got it.
No, okay. It hurt fans. to admit that Wonder Woman was good.
It hurt people. I can tell.
I had people go out of the way to be like, "Well, just saw Wonder Woman. It was only great, not amazing." What?
Only great, like, not amazing.
They were pissed, man. They didn't want it to be good.
All right, let's move on to the next thing that you were trying to get me to say. Kevin Spacey.
You're coming out, buddy.
Kevin Spacey came out.
Oh yeah.
But that's not the big news out of this. I mean, a lot of people always knew that Kevin Spacey was gay. A lot of people would always say, like, oh, but he has a wife and kids. Let's be honest, that's never meant anything when it comes to that. But
Governor that one time.
The show House of Cards has been canceled by Netflix.
Yeah, man. It's doing well. It's a good, successful show, too. It's an
amazing show.
Do you think they, why were they canceled?
Well, it got canceled because Kevin Spacey has been accused of, back in 19...
Allegedly, yes.
He was accused back in 1986 of trying to have sex with... Well, seduce a 14-year-old boy.
The guy from Rent.
Yes.
He was also on Road Trip.
Now, he came out, apparently, and said that this has happened. And there's two sides to this, obviously, that it's kind of sad either way. It's like, all right, well, either you're saying this and you could possibly ruin Kevin Spacey's name, who's, in my opinion, a really good actor. I'm not going to judge him off any of his personal decisions or his personal life, but he's an amazing actor. So, you know, that sucks if you're just saying this to ruin his name, but it also sucks if this actually did happen, because it's like, you know, this isn't something to joke around with.
And I don't know if people were so much more offended about it happening, because it was so long ago. I think a lot of people were upset how Kevin Spacey handled it. And then the whole, if this did happen, I was drunk, oh, by the way, I'm gay.
Yeah.
Kind of not good timing, you know what I mean?
Yeah, like, I can agree.
And I'm not saying that, you know, who knows how anybody would handle a situation like this, you know what I mean? What I think is insane is, do you think Netflix jumped the gun and canceled the show as quickly as they did?
Yeah, I do. I think it was a lot like Disney dropping PewDiePie when that whole thing happened with him on his stream. Apparently he said the N-word on his stream, but they didn't have the context behind it. So, you know, they dropped him, but he's still making a lot of money and people still love watching him. I'm not one of them, but, you know, I feel like Netflix House of Cards, I'm pretty sure, brings in a lot of views for Netflix.
I would be shocked if another place doesn't try to pick it up or do something very similar to it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's surprising. Like I'm saying, there's a lot of accusations going out there right now, and there was even an accusation thrown out at Ben Affleck. Or not an accusation, but somebody brought up something he did, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And instead of, like, DC, like, flipping out and like, oh my god, let's drop him. Yeah, Ben Affleck talked about it, people forgot about it already. It was a week, and, you know, he came out and had to be drunk. Apologized to a girl that said it was like he was drunk. Go ahead. Apologized. You know what I mean? Point being is, I feel like they jumped the gun because who knows how people are going to take this in a week or two. You know what I mean?
I agree. Yeah.
It's not like.
And you also don't know the full story. I mean, you know, Kevin Spacey, if he was drunk, he can't tell you what exactly happened. You know, and the other guy, he was 14.
It was it's not like the Weinstein guy that, like, things are coming out every day. Yeah. You know what I mean? That's a different circumstance than that. Hey, you know what?
Yes.
If something did inappropriately happen back in the day, that is a shame.
Yeah.
You know, very terrible. You know, there's no time frame for you that to get any better, but same time, gonna miss House of Cards.
Yeah. I agree.
I'm on, like, fourth season right now. Should I even finish it? Should I just skip it up?
I think you should just keep going. Kind of as like a last hurrah.
See what you're saying?
So this next thing is going to be our big topic. This is
probably. Going to Paris?
No. Omelette du fromage?
Bless you.
Thank you.
What do they eat in Paris?
Omelette du fromage.
What is that?
Omelette with cheese.
Mmm.
I learned that from Dexter's Laboratory. That episode where wanted to learn.
They all wear, like, striped shirts, though, and stuff, and have hats on, right?
I don't know.
No, that's Venice. That's Venice. What do they wear? Oh, you know what they wear in Paris? Black tight shirts with a chest out, and they all have, like, the cigarette holders.
Wee.
Yes.
So Paris Games Week just went on, and we got a look at a lot of games.
Yes.
So I thought we could talk about each trailer that we saw, what we liked about it, what we didn't like, if we're still excited for the game. And I thought we could start with the one that might actually be the most split between us, I think, and that's Spider-Man. Because you called me up after this happened, and you said that it kind of you lost some excitement for the game.
I did.
And I'm actually still really excited for the game.
Okay, let me refer. I'm still going to get it. It still looks like a gorgeous...
Wow, you're such a... What? You're just going to say you hate something and buy it anyway? No wonder why they keep throwing trash at us. No, I'm joking.
No, it still looks like a great game, and the first trailer got me hyped for it. I'm just saying, I wish I would have seen more. And it's funny, because like I said on the phone to you, I feel like a fanboy crybaby. Because I was like, I hope to show more Peter Parker. And then they show Peter Parker, and I was like, oh, I'm so disappointed. That's not the way he should look in my mind. I don't like the way Peter Parker looks.
Okay.
I feel like he looks really generic. I don't like the way a lot of the models look, actually. Like Aunt May looks great. The villain of the game, it looks like, looks really good. But Peter Parker and Miles, they both don't look great to me.
Yeah, we also don't have a release date yet, so we don't know how much they haven't polished yet, you know what I mean? But I can agree with
you.
The
game was very confusing, because they say it's like 50-50 between Peter Parker and Spider-Man.
Yeah.
But then there's also that one scene where it looked like you were controlling Mary Jane, or could have just been the angle.
It did look like you were controlling Mary Jane at one point, I agree. And it kind of makes you wonder, because Mary Jane also says that Spider-Man might need a friend, so it's like, well, does Miles actually play a part in this?
Yeah. What I'm curious about, though, is so far in the trailer, we got two villains. One, Negative Guy Man, I think it is.
Well, technically three. Would you count Kingpin?
No. He's all beat up in the beginning.
Well, he's in prison, but let's be honest. Just because he's in prison doesn't mean that he's not going
to... First off, when people go to prison, they do nothing but be in prison. That's the end of it.
Well, what do you all right, well, go on. What were you going to say? The two villains. Mr.
Negative Man and, what's his name? Shocker. That's it.
That's all we know so far.
I don't like it.
Why?
Come on. Where's the other villain?
Why do you need other villains?
Because I do. Spider-Man games need like 40 villains. I need to fight him in a particular order. And one of them needs to be Dr. Octopus.
What I think they're going to probably do is set the villains as side quests. And I think Mr. Negative is still going to be our big focus.
Yeah, it's just, as a villain, like, I don't... Who is Mr. Negative? Have you even heard of him?
No. I think he's their own made-up guy. Because this is an original story. So, I don't know, but...
It looks so stupid. And his powers look stupid.
Hey, man. Hey, stupid.
No,
calm down.
Yeah, I'm trying.
Alright.
Where's the Rhino battle in this game?
Spider-Man has an awesome
suit. He
comes
running, and you have to jump over him, and he goes into, like, cars and walls and stuff.
Where's more of the same. That's what you want.
I
want
to be comfortable.
Yeah, that explains why you like Nintendo.
So,
walked into that door.
I did. The trailer looks good. I give it, on the scale to like 1 to 10, it was still one of the better trailers I've seen. I've seen crappier trailers than that.
Okay.
I'm just saying the first trailer was just so much more to me.
Okay.
Which is funny though, because the first trailer a lot of people complained about because it looked like a lot of quick time events.
Yeah.
This one definitely looked like it had more gameplay and more story. So, it still looks like a great game. I'm still going to get it, you know?
Yeah.
It would have to be like something crazy to come out. Also, I'm a bit of a hipster because you know I don't like Spider-Man that much.
Yeah, you don't. Spider-Man used to be my favorite hero until Civil War ruined him. But we won't get into that. Let's get into the next trailer, though, because I did really like Spider-Man, but I think we talked enough about that one. I mean, there wasn't really too much, in my opinion, to really focus on.
Do you like Peter Parker's hair?
Not really.
It's like fro, man. I don't,
yeah,
know
it does look a little more... Froish. Mm-hmm. But next up, and I think this is one that you and me were both very excited for, and that's The Last of Us 2. Whew. Let's talk about how a trailer, and I'm just going to throw this out there right now, a trailer that didn't have Joel or Ellie still kept me on the edge of my seat. Yep. And made me care about characters that, yes, I don't even know their
name. Not to mention, there wasn't even infected in it until what?
Not even, no more than 5 seconds.
Because
you didn't even get to see it clearly,
no.
But you just knew what it was.
That one... The game, it looks like it's same thing with the first one. It's not afraid to shy away from anything.
No.
And it really didn't. The best part of it was in the trailer, they didn't tell you who the bad guys were, who were the good guys. You have no idea why they're doing what they're doing. But you immediately, just with the tension, the feel, the way the characters were moving, interacting, you felt for the girl that was getting on, and these other people, you were terrified of them. And it just, the tension, the way the game looked, it was just delicious.
Yes. And so another thing I thought we could talk about real quick before we really get deep into this trailer. A lot of people, and even journalists seem to be attacking the game, saying that it's really promoting female violence and stuff like that. But they don't seem to realize that it was a woman that was leading this group of guys, telling them to do this. So let's just talk about the trailer, then I guess we could talk about this, how we feel about that later. But I know the trailer starts with them dragging a woman out,
yeah.
And they're about to hang her. They put the rope around her, lift her up.
Got a little bucket that she's handing on, which is terrifying.
And they only dropped her enough that her tippy toes could touch the bucket.
Yeah.
They were not giving her anything.
Nope. And it's a bit of an interrogation scene. I think when that first arrow comes out of nowhere and just sticks the guy, it's, you know, the direction you're going in. Like you said, I thought that was going to be Ellie for a minute.
Me too.
And then comes out, it's this
Asian guy.
You know what I mean? Glenn.
Yeah.
So who do you think these characters are and interacting in the game? Do you think it's they're part of Ellie's group, maybe? Do you think these are the remnants of the Fireflies? Because at the end of the day, he said, when the one girl said, cut her down, he was like, she's one of them. She said, cut her down. So what do you think that's about? Oh, and then you remember when he bashed her
arm. That was something I was going to say. Before the whole arrow thing even happens, they find, like, the Asian girl, and they drag her over, and they ask the Asian girl to, I guess, to give out her group, because there are more of them. They want to know where they are, and she refuses. So the woman says to clip her wings. When I first heard that, I thought they were going to do something else. I didn't know that they meant the arms. I thought it was going to be something with her back. And then they pin her down, and you just see them whack her arms with this hammer. And it's brutal. Like, you know, they don't really shy away from what they're doing there. And then we see the arrow go into the one guy's head, and we get all that. I kind of took this trailer, to be honest, to have to do more with the multiplayer. Because there was a multiplayer for the first Last of Us. There were different groups. And I thought it would be cool if there was maybe a game mode where you could kidnap teammates. And once you kidnap them, that's how you got to see the opponent constantly on the map.
Hmm.
Like you interrogate them type of thing. That might be a little bit far-fetched, though, because that's a lot. No one would really get that from a trailer, to be honest. I don't know why I even got that from the trailer. But I thought it was just so weird to show no Ellie or Joel in this trailer, and it's like, I don't know who's on what side. I don't know who's the good or bad guy.
Yeah, exactly. And like I said, all we know in the first game, there was the Fireflies.
Yeah.
There was the Runners. That was Joel and the girl from the beginning.
Yeah.
And then you had the Militia, what was left of the American government. And it's like, where do any of these people lie in it? You know what I mean? Are they Runners? Are they gangs? Is this all on the outskirts of
a new town or something.
A new town, you know what I mean?
Or is this a whole new group, you know? Because don't forget, like, you play the whole game of the first Last of Us, and this is going to be a slight spoiler, so I'm sorry for anyone who hasn't played it. You play the whole game, and really, you think you're the good guy the whole time, but you find out by the end of the game that you are the villain.
Mm-hmm.
The whole time you played the bad guy. So I'm curious as to, like, you know, who is anyone really bad? Was that woman that unfortunately gets strangled by the other lady's legs and gets a hammer jammed into the side of her skull, was she the bad guy? You know, like, it's such a world of gray than it is black and white, in my opinion.
I think one, the game wanted to show us what this game was going to look like, what to expect in this game. Like I said,
visually,
eventually I'm pretty sure we'll find out where these characters lie. Now, Joel is got to be in his 50s, I think, in First Last of Us. And this looks like it takes 10 years.
I didn't think he was in his 50s in the first one. I thought he was maybe in his, like, late 40s.
There's no way.
You don't think so?
His daughter is 14 in the beginning.
Uh-huh.
So he had been at least 34. What an
idiot. Okay.
Okay, then the jump's 20 years.
Was it a 20-year gap?
It was a 20-year gap, correct.
Okay, then I will agree with you. I didn't think it was a 20-year gap.
Mm-hmm.
But okay.
So now Ellie looks pretty grown.
She does, yeah.
What is Joel's story going to be? Is he in this game?
Well, that was one of the theories from the first trailer we ever saw. You know, we do think that Joel could be dead. You know, maybe someone got to him and Ellie's just imagining him. But
kind of like he'll be in the game, kind of like how the Joker was in the last Batman game?
Yes.
That'd be interesting. I'd like to play Joel.
I really like Joel, but I don't know if we're going to play as him this time. I think it's really going to be Ellie. that's the playable character.
I agree. And it was cool in the first Last of Us game and the expansion when you get to play as Ellie.
Yeah.
She was a very, I think she's probably, Naughty Dog just does great with their female characters.
They really do. If you look at the Uncharted series too.
None of them have ever had damsel in distress mode, and they've all been really tough, love, character first characters. Really nice. And if you don't know what I mean by that, like, put any gender in that character and they'll still be relevant. And that's what's really nice about them.
Yeah. So how do you feel about, like, these people saying about, oh, this is promoting female violence and stuff like that? Like,
I feel like people are always going to have complaints. You know what I mean? I still remember when Bully was coming out.
Yeah.
And Hillary Clinton and everybody went out of their mind crazy about how this game was teaching violence to school and bullying and all that. The game's legit about fighting bullies.
Yeah, the complete opposite.
Yeah, but I'm not shocked. You know what I mean? People are always going to complain about something. You know, it's ridiculous. And it's on both sides, man. I don't care if you're liberal, Democrat, conservative, you know, whatever you are. People will have something to complain about.
The thing that really bothers me about this is I feel like this is what starts to limit writers' creativity. I feel like then they have to worry about, okay, if I do this, am I going to upset people?
We'll go to when Wolfenstein came out, people are losing their mind because you fight Nazis and the KKK.
Yeah.
These people are bad people. Like, and the developers, instead of going, oh, you know, they're like, F you. You kill bad guys. That's what it is. So I'm hoping most developers take that mentality. Like,
me too.
You don't want to play a bad game because you don't want to kill Nazis. Well, obviously you're Nazi and I don't want you buying my game anyway. So, crybabies. All of them.
Okay.
Every one of them.
Next up we have...
I'm still pissed about this. What did
you say? Shadow of the Colossus.
Now I'm not so bad.
We got a big look at this. And we got quite a bit of information too. We got a release date. We got a price. And we got gameplay.
Are you excited that we're getting it? Looks like it's February, isn't it?
February 6th.
Yes. It's right around the corner, man.
That is really close. I'm super excited for one. Let me also just say this right now before we even talk about the trailer. Sony knows how to price these remasters. $40.
It comes with more stuff.
Yeah.
It's extra bosses in this. Yeah.
So. The game is beautiful. Like, every time when that trailer came on, I was like, God, the gameplay's so good. It looks like it plays exactly the same.
Yes.
Like, you just see him jump off the horse onto the flying desert one. I remember that one where you have to shoot the sack so that it will drop down.
Yeah.
But I'm just so excited.
I think anybody that's played this game is excited. You know what I mean? Like, I can't picture you... I've never met anybody that was like, oh, I played Shadow of the Colossus, I just didn't like it. Anybody that doesn't like the game never played it. This is as simple as that.
I can agree with that.
And be honest, Sony, you can release this game every time a new system comes out, because I'll buy it every time.
Man. Honestly, I was prepared to pay $60 for it. In my head, I was willing to, because it's one of my favorite games of all time. It's probably in my top 10, personally.
I agree with that.
And I was like, $60 for this beautiful game, and... that I can't ever get enough of. Like, when it came to the PS3, I got it again.
I even tried playing Ico first, and I ended up just going right to Shadow of the
Colossus. It's funny, because I tried the same thing. Not that Ico's a bad game.
No, I think
it's good. But I think that From Japan really hit something special with Shadow of the Colossus, and I feel bad for them.
I still feel like it hasn't lived up to that, because
Last Guardian, yeah, it hasn't had that same magic, and I agree, and I feel bad for them, because I do think that they're a talented company, and I think they made their golden egg a little too soon.
I agree, they've talked about that game in movies, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They talked about it in games. South Park, what's the last achievement you get in Stick of Truth? Shadow of the Colossus, the game for GameSphere. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
that, it's something that's, like I said, anybody that's played it, it's like, wow, this is such an experience. Every time my wife asks me what the game is again, I smile when I start describing it to her. Because it's just that fun to talk about.
It's just boss battles. And that's what's also so fun about it. Like,
but everybody had a different experience on it. I'll never forget. My favorite class is the one with the huge sword.
Yeah.
And I'm on his back, and he's got the weak point right on the top of his head, you know, in the little balding spot for everybody. And he does the wiggle thing, and I fall. And I knew I was going to hit the ground, but instead I hit that little belt thing and just caught at such an angle where I was able to hold on and climb up. I remember having to pause the game because my hands were sweaty, my face was sweaty, and just be like, oh, and they finished the battle, and it was such, like, that was such an emotional moment for me. Same thing with, and it's not only just boss battles, some of the ways, you don't even know you're getting to another Colossus, you're just exploring, and then all of a sudden you enter, and what you thought was a rock formation just gets up and starts moving, yep. You know what I mean? Like, what's that horse one? That comes trampling down the long tunnel thing. I had no idea I was about to battle a Colossus. I had no idea it was on top of me until the thing came running by me.
One of my favorite Colossus was the hawk in the lake, because when you're at the lake, his wings will just come down, and I thought it was just so beautiful that you see like these waves of water. And you just gotta time the jump, because you can't swim. Well, your character can swim, but you can't get on it if you're in the water. You have to literally get on this stone structure, jump from the stone structure onto the wing. And it just always felt so epic. And every time you're holding on to something, you watch your little meter get smaller, and you're like, hurry up.
So then you hold yourself in the one place.
Yep. Because if you didn't move, it wouldn't go as fast. It would still shrink, but not as fast. And you just prayed that he would either put his wings back in a horizontal motion so you could refill your bar, or that Colossus would move just enough.
And it's always so funny, because their weak points would move. So you'd get it one spot, and then all of a sudden you'd roll, tumble somewhere, and then all of a sudden you would see it, and like, and you'd try to roll. Oh, man.
Yeah.
I can't wait for this game. I love it. And then I loved aiming the sword.
In the sky? Direction. Yeah. It was such an epic thing, and I it's one of those things that I remember as a kid when I played the first Shadow of the Colossus. I was like, man, I wish I could take a screenshot of me riding the horse with this light going.
Yep.
And now I'm in a world where I can do that this time.
I tell you, every time I take a Colossus down, I think I'm going to share the event of just killing each Colossus.
Alright, let's...
And that's another game where, like, I feel like it teaches you, not a lesson of sorts, but, you know, you feel emotional attached.
You do, yeah. And it's I don't know, it's just such a special game. I hope people really give it a shot. If you've never played it, this is the time to really... I think jump in on it, especially for $40. Why not?
Absolutely.
Next up, though, we have Spelunky 2.
Bless you.
Thank you. Spelunky is a kind of procedurally generated treasure diving game. So the first one was. Now this one, they kind of reference the moon. So I don't know.
Outer space thing.
I don't know. Yeah. So the game you now play as the main character's daughter this time. And, you know, she's going to go on her own adventure. And that was one of the things that they say. Like, you know, don't just look down. Make sure you're looking up into the sky. And they show the moon. So it's like, wonder if I'm going to be in the moon.
Now, I was going to ask the question with that, with the whole moon thing. The first one was a kind of underground thing, which was
a lot of temples. Looked like, it reminded me a lot of Indiana Jones.
Yeah. What was the author that's done the Journey to the Center of the Earth? On the moon, 1,000 leagues, I can't remember his name. I'm thinking that maybe, talking about theories, I'm thinking, do you think there's a way that maybe some of these games would be based off his adventures? I just think it's weird that we've done Temple, Doom, Underground kind of thing, next is Moon, which will be kind of the order of his books.
Yeah, then I guess after that would technically be the sea.
Yep, exactly.
If there is a third, let's not jump the gun, but...
So, pricing of the game?
I don't think they talked about that. But the first game was relatively cheap. I think it was only like $15. It was free on PSN a couple of times.
Yes.
It's a good game, though. Like, it's a lot of fun. It's very addicting. I'm excited for the second one. They didn't show any gameplay, so, you know, it's still early.
Probably far out. But at the same time, what could they show?
That's
really going to be like, oh, wow, this is
more Spelunky.
Yeah.
Yeah. The second thing, the next thing that they showed, I think it was a VR game. I'm not entirely sure. Concrete Genie?
Yeah, I didn't try to look this up, couldn't find it. What is this?
Once again, I don't know if it's VR or not, but it was a street kid and he gets a magic paintbrush and he's painting the city. And while you're painting the city, the things you're painting are coming to life. So you get like these critters and this forest and on. It looked pretty cool. Like there's neon lights and things like that. Then you have these evil teenagers who are going around and blackening your art. They just want to destroy your nice things you made.
Sixth graders.
Yeah, so I don't... It would make more sense as a PSVR game, you know, to use
the
wand
painting,
to paint.
Yeah.
So I'm curious if that's what it is, but I'm not entirely sure. I think it looks interesting, but I wasn't very impressed by it.
I don't know. If it's still one of those, like, you have to use your wand and the things you paint come to life, they always look great on paper until you try it, because you can never paint in straight lines. Like, ooh, I'm going to make a fox, but it ends up only having three legs. And you know, his head's on the wrong spot. You're like, oh.
Why does your fox have five legs? It only has four.
Okay.
What's the thing? Oh.
Oh. Oh. Kill it, kill it. That's why games like Scribblenauts worked for me, because it was literally just writing. There's no way to mess writing
yeah.
versus drawing, you know?
You've gotten quite but a lot stronger than I wasn't too impressed personally with any of the VR stuff, really. Another game that we got that was next for VR was Erica. And I thought that was kind of cool. I'm not going to lie. For the whole trailer, I kept wondering if it was live action or if it was CGI. Because there were some people in it that looked CGI and some people that looked real. So I don't know. And it's pretty alarming, because if it was all real, that means there are people out there that look like they're CGI. And we should probably encamp them all.
Some
run experiments.
Yeah, and probably get them to see a doctor, take medication. I'm going to be honest, none of the VR stuff really jumped out at me to, like, own a VR. There still has been nothing on
this. Me neither. And a lot of it looked very generic still. You know, there was nothing. It's not like Sony was like, guess what, you're going to get to play The Last of Us 2 in VR.
Oh, that'd be terrifying. Imagine the rope going around.
Oh, God, that would have been crazy.
Honestly, like, and I feel like, we talked about it, I feel like I like there's that Star Wars game coming out that's VR, but it's its own thing, you know what I mean? That on the PlayStation VR, I feel like, would be something to push you to get VR. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Be able to do these epic lightsaber battles in VR. But none of the stuff is like, so far I've seen a lot of B horror stuff.
Yeah, or there's always these heist-like games.
Yeah, you know? And I always hate seeing it, and I hate watching people play VR, because even in the videos I watch, the controls aren't great. You know, I see somebody put their hand up like 40 times to get it to respond.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. I'm like, that's happening in the gameplay. What happens when I go to bring this thing home?
You know what would be kind of cool for, like, a heist idea? And I know it's pretty generic still, but you remember the movie Wanted?
No.
You don't remember Wanted?
No, but Angelina Jolie?
Yeah.
The curved bullet?
Yeah.
Morgan Freeman?
Yeah.
No.
Okay. Well, they did this thing where you could curve the bullet.
Yes.
I think it'd be pretty cool if they made a game like that.
Where you could curve the bullet and everything like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't like that movie.
Delta hidden. Get out.
Well, that movie loved it.
Yeah, same thing with, like, the Blood and Truth was the game that I was talking about, where it just seemed very generic. It was that heist game.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I agree with you 100%. I think Sony, it's nice that Sony's even supporting the VR, but I do think that they need to start really hitting it with some big titles, you know? And I don't mean make, like, the next Last of Us only VR, because that is going to just upset some people. But it'd be cool if you had sections that were like, all right, you know, if you buy The Last of Us 3, not saying there's going to be a Last of Us 3, you know, let's just go with Last of Us 2, because that is going to exist. You do The Last of Us 2, you can play, it'll have a separate portion of the game that you can do in VR.
Or Resident Evil 7 was a prime example. When you both played that game regular, terrifying. We both agree that in VR, probably even more scary.
Yeah.
But you had that option. You know what I mean? Something to do. I think all first persons should be coming out in VR.
I agree.
And the fact that they're not is ridiculous. Like, even playing this new Call of Duty, there are certain sections that I played in the game where I think VR would have been amazing for it. Like, there's a part of the game where your character falls and there's all this stuff coming down next to you. And I feel like in VR, that would have been, you know, amazing.
Yeah.
You know?
I agree with that. I do think all first person shooters at least should all have VR. Then we also got Far Cry 5 multiplayer trailer.
I know I've said this before, but there every time I see anything about this game, and you know I don't play multiplayer, so it says a lot about this, I'm getting more and more excited for this game.
Oh yeah, me too.
And you know I don't play multiplayer, and the fact that this trailer sold me with a multiplayer trailer,
we
for you.
Can fish together.
What did you think I was talking about?
Let me tell you something. I saw that whole trailer. And you know what? I was like, you know what? I'm already pretty excited for this game. I don't really need to see anymore. And then I saw him fish. I was like, holy shit. That fish looked so real.
It's funny, though. Everybody is talking about this fishing mechanic in this game. Like, the story looks amazing in this game. The game looks fantastic. I'm really... Like, I'm really thinking it's very interesting, though. A lot of people are excited about this fishing mechanic. What do you think it is that's really catching people?
I don't know, because to be honest, my favorite, one of my favorite things to do in Final Fantasy 15
is fish.
Is fish.
Same thing.
And I don't know what it is. I don't know if a part of me, a deep down child, just really likes fishing. I don't know. But every time I see fishing in a game, I'm like, I could fish all day.
It's so comedy. And it's so, especially when you catch a big one. And you're like,
oh, yeah.
Look what I've done.
Yeah. And they show it off in Final Fantasy. I don't know how this is going to work, but I'm excited.
Do you think this Far Cry, this will finally put Far Cry on a level with a Call of Duty or, you know, a GTA or something?
Not like in the sense of, like, versus multiplayer for Call of Duty. Mm-hmm. But I will say, I think Far Cry 3 has had a better story than most Call of Duties.
Okay.
And I'm not going to say anything when it comes to GTA, because GTA is a whole nother beast, you know what I mean? I do think Far Cry 3, in my opinion, was better story than most GTA.
Well, when I say GTA and Call of Duty, when I went to the Midnight for Call of Duty, there was just a lot of
people. Oh, you mean, is this...
When I go to the Midnight for, you know, Grand Theft Auto, or anything Rockstar, there's a lot of people.
This going to be the one that puts Far Cry like...
Far Cry is a game that, on the regular, it might skip a year, but they're on the regular, they usually put one out a year, and is this going to be that game where it makes finally people come?
I think this one has a really good chance of being the game. It looks beautiful, for one, and let's be honest, a lot of people care about graphics as much as they say they don't.
Well, you know, as much as I try not to be hipster, too, looking at you playing Wolfenstein today, I would look even better on my TV. I might do that.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Let's hope it doesn't break again.
Wow. What a terrible human being you are.
I
hope you're proud of yourself for that rude comment.
We saw the first Destiny 2 expansion trailer. I don't know. I wasn't really impressed with it.
I'm
tired of seeing the same looking enemies. Like, the Vex is the... It seems like this raid is going to be based on the Vex. And it's like... Jesus Christ, can you just give us something different? Like, these are all the same races that were in the first game.
I told you, I feel the way about Destiny. I feel like this is a big multiplayer Halo. That's all Destiny. I really honestly feel that way.
Yeah.
About Destiny.
And I mean,
gorgeous game.
Yeah.
You know, fun.
And Halo never really expanded too much when it came to alien races.
I feel like they're very comfortable on it. And besides, look at their fan base, man.
I know. I just don't get it.
You know, the whole time I was there picking up Call of Duty, everybody's like, well, I guess I'll stop playing Destiny for a while so I can play this, and then I'll play Destiny again. Well, and then I was the weird one, so like, you play Destiny? I was like, no, Borderlands. And I looked at me like, I was weird.
Like, I'm sorry, they're not the same.
Yes. The Borderlands looks like the cartoon.
So I don't really want to talk about the Destiny 2 trailer, honestly, too much. It just showed some...
Do you think it'll sell?
Absolutely. I mean, like... It was a cool-looking trailer, I'm not going to lie. It was pretty cool. It showed, like, this guy with the hawk helmet. I don't even remember. I think his name's, like, Oasis or something. He was kind of cool. But I just don't... I don't know. Kind of reminded me of Egypt.
Okay.
I just don't care.
I can see that. But the next one, I think we both care a little bit about.
Oh, I think it's more than a little. This is the one that I honestly... Alone, I could probably... We could probably have a whole podcast just on this game. Because of all the news we just got out of it. But, Monster Hunter.
Alright. I don't know where to start off with. Monster Hunter made me feel glad to bought Marvel vs. Capcom. That's how excited I am about this game. That if knowing my money to that game is might give them a little more money to this game, I'm okay with purchasing Marvel vs. Capcom.
Okay. So we got a new area.
The whole look at the new area, too.
Yeah, they showed us a lot. They showed... Now, it looks like a very decayed area. There's gases, and you even see your character cover his mouth a little when he walks through it, so yeah. I'm curious if that's going to be a gameplay mechanic where you need a gas mask, or you need something to get through
that.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
That would be cool.
The inside stomach of one of the monsters that you can breathe into, something like that.
Yeah, now they have...
That's a thing they did in the past, the game, was you would need certain parts of a monster to get through certain areas.
Yes.
So I'm kind of curious on that.
So we did get a bit of news about the entire game, too. So let's get into that, and then we'll talk about the pieces of the trailer. One thing is the entire game, even the main missions, are co-op. You can play co-op. Which, in the original Monster Hunter games, you had certain missions you couldn't do with friends. You had to do it alone. That's gone. The entire game can be played with friends in co-op.
Now this time, when you're carrying the egg, I can have your back the entire time.
Yes.
Sorry, no, bro. I'm never going to get over that ache.
It's okay. They also did away with a lot of the monotonous quests, like collecting the bugs, going out and getting berries. Those aren't quests anymore, but they are things that you can still track to increase different things of your own.
Well, the way I looked at it is while you're doing these major missions or quests, you can pick those things up
yes.
on the side. Kind of like the dog tags from Gears.
Yes.
Where you're in the middle of something, you just happen to see it.
This now doesn't count. They don't count now as main missions.
Right.
They're now their own little, I guess, side quests, and you can pick up more than one of them. It's, you know, it's not a big deal, whereas before it's like, oh, this is taking up space. I have to go knock it out.
Yes.
Another thing that we know is you get your own house like before, but you get pets this time. So you get a bug net, and you can catch different creatures and release them within your house. I thought that was pretty cool.
What do you, visually, what do you think of this game?
Oh, beautiful.
Am I crazy?
So
it looks
beautiful.
So good.
So beautiful.
I have a crazy theory. Are they running on like an 8K monitor? Is that why the game looks? Because it looks like it's running amazingly.
Yes.
And the game looks gorgeous to begin with.
Yeah.
So I'm having trouble thinking that's running on like a PS4 Pro.
Well, I guess it is, because, I mean, it comes out really soon.
It does, so. Yeah.
But we also got to look at a lot of new monsters. One was kind of like, it's on four legs, and a lot of the monsters in this game seem to be on four legs, whereas before they all kind of seemed like wyvern type in
right.
the previous games. But one of them was on four legs, kind of had like a snake type head, and its ability is that when it hits you, you get stunned. I thought that was pretty cool. That was interesting.
Especially co-op. Can you imagine that? Fighting with it, someone together.
Yeah. Oh, all the fights are also going to be scaled depending on who you're playing with. So the difficulty for a fight will increase the more people you're playing with. So it's,
word.
Which I enjoy, because I don't ever want to be at a point where it's like, oh, this is easy because I'm playing with all my friends.
That was a big problem with Destiny. You know, you ran in with top level people, you were flying through a boss, no
yeah.
issue.
I agree.
So that's actually really neat. I know the game's right around the corner, but I want it today.
What the hell? Oh, yeah,
and
me too.
I want it tomorrow.
Well, we are getting a beta. If you're a PS Plus member, December 9th, you can play the game. So I think that's also a really good time to figure out what class you would like to play.
And I feel like this is them knowing that they got something with this game that they're giving away the beta like that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
I think it's also really smart, because while Monster Hunter is a big series, let's be honest, I think it was kind of held back being only on the 3DS.
Besides the 3DS, it's a very Japanese
yes.
game. Number two, I feel like there's a lot of people that I've seen that talk to me and been like, oh, what's that game they showed at E3, or what's that game they showed at Paris where you fought the monsters? Oh, Monster Hunter. It's been around forever. But to them, it's something new. You know
yeah.
what I mean? We talked about it before, but I think that's why they called it Monster Hunter World.
Well, that is. There was an article that came out, and that is what they said. They wanted to name it Monster Hunter World because they didn't want to detract people from coming to the game if they called it 5.
Right.
It is 5, technically. But none of the Monster Hunters ever actually lead into one another. So, but that's really exciting for me. I'm super stoked to play the game.
Now, do you think, because looking at these monsters, they look kind of different from the monsters. Even the character you're playing as looks a bit different. Do you think this is going to have a new story or to explain why this world looks so different?
Well, they did say that this is the first time that the campaign is really cinematic. Like, it does have cutscenes, and so I'm going to assume that that's what this is going to do. But we'll see.
And I don't know if it's because it's been running on Nintendo for so long that it's going from cartoonish.
Oh,
I don't want to
yeah.
say cartoonish, but definitely a stylized choice in looks to.
Yeah.
You can see the scales. You can see feathers. You know what I mean? You can actually see a living, breathing world in
yeah,
this game.
Yeah, I agree. And well, so they recently were asked, the Monster Hunter devs were asked if they had any plans to bring it over to the Nintendo Switch. Doesn't look like that's going to happen. They said that we had a vision in store. We really don't want to have to change it to bring to any other platform. They said that, you know, it is a possibility to look into, maybe, but as of right now, it's definitely not something that's going to happen. Moving on, though, I think I'm going to skip the Call of Duty World War II trailer.
Why?
Because it's already out.
Is it?
Yeah. But we did get a new Star Wars Battlefront 2 trailer. I wasn't, you know, I don't think it really showed anything new.
Although the trailer was really cool with the campaign, I will because I was burned so bad by the first one, I'm going to give it a bit before I pick this up.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I'll let somebody else be my guinea pig.
Yeah. Well, I don't think, like I said, I don't think this game, one, it hasn't, like, pushed the needle either way for me. I'm still excited for it, but I don't think this trailer really showed anything new that was worthy of it being there, type of thing. I know it was probably just there to build up more hype for its release,
I mean, it's
which
smart,
is right around the corner.
It was smart doing Call of Duty and Star Wars, because they're both around the corner.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Then we had God of War. And
not much from it, but enough.
No. It was a very small bit. You saw this large Titan-type thing. I think they called it an elemental.
Yes.
And he lifts up the gate.
And your son was like, you know, what do we do? And Kratos, I love that Kratos was like, he's not bothering us. We're not bothering him. You
yeah.
know what I mean?
And then he walks away and he's like, well, Mom said that they were way more dangerous than that. And he was like, well, then we should probably be careful.
Right.
But I think you just, they goes right into the combat, which one is really brutal. Like, God of War has always been that
way. What I've noticed in this, too, and I didn't mean to cut you off, but it really never feels like the game goes in from cutscene to combat. Like, it always feels like it's over that shoulder view. It always feels seamless. Like, he literally, I thought it was still a cutscene when he started fighting.
Yeah.
To realize, no, this is actual gameplay.
Yeah. I like that your son helps you in the combat.
Yes. Like, warns you when people are coming. Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought that was
He's like, Dad, behind you. And then, you know, he throws the axe at that.
So, do you think the axe is enchanted of some sort?
Oh,
like, what's,
absolutely.
Yeah, because that,
Come
first
on.
Off, it's weird. Like, it almost looks like he's throwing it every time he's moving it. And it almost has a chain look to it still. Like the chain.
It still looks like he has the Blades of Chaos.
So, what do you think, with we know this is Norse mythology, but what do you think is up with that axe?
I don't know, to be honest. Obviously, it's runed, because it does have carvings in on it, too. We've noticed that. So, those rune carvings have to be what gives it its magical properties, I'm assuming. Because it does look like it also has frost on it. Like, I've always noticed, like, this blue frost aura type
yeah.
around it, which I thought was cool.
Think we'll get other weapons besides that?
I think a trailer from E3 showed the shield, and he shield bashed someone.
Yeah, we have it in our opening.
Yeah, but I believe that that's all we've seen. I hope there's more. Don't get me wrong, but we'll see.
Well, this is kind of like a reboot. And in the first game, you got the chains, a spear, if I'm not mistaken, and a sword.
Yeah,
or
I think
a hammer,
so.
I think. So maybe, definitely.
But I thought that they showed just enough to keep me interested and keep my interest peaked. Another game that every time I see more on it, I get more interested in. That's Detroit.
That's for What's-His-Face.
Yes.
Jesse Williams.
Now, this time the trailer showed a female character. It was an android, and she's taking care of a little girl. And the dad is, like, a super dick. Like, he's just a bad guy, and you kind of get the hints from the trailer that he killed the mother. But says that the mom walked out on him. Now, there are numerous ways that they show that whole scenario can play out. Apparently, he kills his daughter, or you can save the daughter. It's just interesting, and it just made me so excited. You know what I mean? It remind me of Heavy Rain, where it looks like my choices actually will have consequences.
That's what's getting me excited now. As much as I love Indigo Prophecies and Heavy Rain, I did not like Beyond Two Souls.
Beyond Two Souls, my biggest problem with that game was it felt like no matter what I did, it didn't matter.
Yes.
I was at do you remember the scene in Beyond Two Souls? A little spoilish, not super, but remember the scene when you're at the house party? So the boy's sitting down with me, we're talking about some stuff, and I choose to tell him that I have an entity following me. His next line is, "You want to go dance?" I'm sorry, what? I just told you my deepest secret.
You want to go dance.
And it's almost as if, like, no matter what I said next, that's what he was going to say to me.
Besides, there was a lot of mistakes in that game. I felt like it got a little too big for its bridges. And that's what I'm really worried about with this one. But maybe they realize that, hey, we made a mistake with Beyond Two Souls. Let's scale it back. I don't, like I said, this is another one where I'm going to let other people be guinea pig for.
You're welcome. Horizon DLC.
I'm really excited for this game, man.
Me too. And you know,
and it's so funny because I bought it, traded in, and I'm really going to pick it up again just to play this DLC.
Yeah. It looks really good, too.
It does.
Now, I haven't noticed any new robots yet. That's my only disappointing part of it so far. It is DLC.
I definitely think we're going to get something. At least one.
Yeah, it is DLC, and if you're a PS Plus member, it is only $15 for the DLC, $20 normally. So it's not super expensive either. So I guess I can't really be super picky, but it does look really good. The story looks really good. The characters, the environment. I think it's so cool to be in just this frozen tundra.
Yes.
This time.
I did like the frozen parts in the beginning of Horizon. Me too. So I'm actually really excited. I do like that we're still playing as the same character. I kind of hope it explores her a little bit more. You know what I mean? It goes into that whole idea. So I'm excited. Either way.
And the last trailer that I wanted to talk about was Final Fantasy XV Episode Ignis.
Was that a popular game?
Oh, yeah. And this episode is your favorite character of the brothers, I'll say. They're not even actually brothers, but, no, you know, it's brotherly love. But,
the whole time you just say, I got it.
I hope the whole episode is just you learning new recipes.
That's it.
Yeah. That'd be great. You're just in a chef.
Yes.
I know. We know it's not. Because
it's going to be delicious.
The trailer shows, what was the girl's name? Luna, was it?
Yes.
We saw Luna's brother, and it seems like he's your partner this time. Mm. Because in each one of the episodes, Gladius teamed up with, the guy that was in the beginning of the game. You had Prompto, who teamed up with Arneas. She's the girl with the Dragoon Lancer.
Right.
And it seems like this time it's going to be Ignis who teams up with Luna's brother. And it actually looks like they both save Luna and Noctis, because I remember seeing them carrying them out of some blaze.
Right.
Are you excited for this?
Yeah, absolutely. One, I think it's really neat that they did that. They're exploring all these side characters, too. Like you said, it's my favorite character.
Yeah.
And Final Fantasy. And I feel like that was the best part of 15. Everybody had their own character. They kind of got down with.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Everybody makes fun of my character. They think he's a joke.
Ignis was my second favorite. Prompto was my least. And then Gladius was probably my first favorite of them. Well, Noctis was my favorite of all four, but Gladius was my favorite.
Because he wore no shirt.
I liked Gladius for a couple of reasons. One, he really loved ramen, and I love ramen.
Okay.
But anyway, go on.
No shirt, though.
He did have amazing pecs and abs. And when he came back later in the game, a badass scar.
Do you think this is going to be it for the DLC, or do you think they're going to do one more?
If they do more, I hope it's not something... I hope it's included in the season pass, and I hope they don't burn people like other companies have. You know what I mean? I don't... But this game has been huge. You know what I mean? Like, I would say this is probably the biggest Final Fantasy they've had since maybe 10.
I agree with that.
Like, I think 10 was probably the last...
Only reason I'm saying... And it's so funny, because I usually hate all this extra DLC. That world was so fun for me, I don't want it to be over.
Yeah.
And although these stories are nice, I want another thing that takes place in that world. You know what I mean?
I wouldn't mind one that takes place while he's an adult again.
Mm.
When he has the facial hair. Give me a reason to go. Because, honestly, you didn't have a reason to stay in the future world after you beat it. You know what I mean? You always just kind of went back in time.
Right.
So I think it would be cool to have a reason to stay in that future world for, like, a side mission.
I'd be honest, probably some of the funnest side missions are with the creature hunts and that. And I would love a lot more of those. You know what I mean? Some more unique ones.
That'd be cool.
Almost, like, comparable to Shadow of the Colossus. That'd be really cool.
Ooh.
Like, that cobra that's on the bank of the water, the one you gotta be, like, leveled up to take down.
What if they added an enemy that was so big, when you teleport, you had to teleport to different parts of his body, and it was like layers? That
word.
You, just like a Colossus.
Nice. That, like God of War 1, that fat chick where you gotta run up her rolls. Or that's God of War 2, excuse me.
Yeah. But I remember that. So that's it for Paris Games Week. You know what? I did want to bring up one more. I forgot to put it in there. Guacamelee 2. Did you look that up?
I did. He's a luchador.
He is.
With a mask.
It looks like you.
I can see that. So I went and looked up some reviews, and the game seemed to be loved. Seems to be a fun, fast-paced game. Question is, did it leave room for a sequel?
Not necessarily. So it kind of ends with you beating the devil, and then, you know, that's pretty much it. But this villain doesn't have to be the devil for the second one. You know what I mean? You did beat Death. But, hey, you know, you can bring other stuff back.
Okay. Alright. What's the villain for the second one?
It looked like it was a woman. But I would say that Guacamelee's story, while it was really funny and charming at times, I think the gameplay is what really makes Guacamelee shine. Like, it's so arcade-ish, but it's a lot of fun. You know, like, you get these different powers, and one will be so that you can get through a green wall. And you'll just see all these series of walls appearing while you're fighting, or you'll see different colored enemies appear, and you're like, oh, I gotta make sure I use this move to knock them out of that color so that I can actually deal damage to them. I think it's just really cool.
I can see that.
But I would say if you haven't played the first Guacamelee, check it out. The second Guacamelee is coming out, and I just thought it was at least worth mentioning that, because that game is very special as well.
I do want another different kind of map, though.
You actually do get different costumes. You get a chicken costume in the first game.
Well, now, that's it.
So let's talk about EA now. EA Access says that EA is now looking into other platforms to bring EA Access to, which, let's be honest, really kind of probably means one of two things. It's either PlayStation or the Switch. Probably not the Switch, because EA doesn't want to support the Switch anymore. What are you going to get on EA Access? Just FIFA 18 on the Switch? No, thank you. It's PlayStation.
Calm down, buddy. Calm down. Could mean the PC.
Well, it's already on PC.
That's what I said. Could mean, okay.
It's on PC and Xbox, so the only two options, really.
What about Mac?
Don't you ever talk to me like that again.
Sorry.
It's okay.
Sorry. Well, that would make sense. I can't really see them making too much money with the Xbox. Well, the Xbox One X is coming out this month.
But it's already on Xbox.
Yeah. So, you know, maybe sales will go up for the Xbox now that the Xbox One X is coming out. How do you see it doing well?
I don't know. I see it possibly doing well. I think what's really going to hurt it is those download size. Have you seen that? Mm-hmm. So Quantum Break has a download size to bring it up to 4K. Maybe now the hair won't look like Ken doll hair, but it's 178 gigabytes.
Well, how big is the hard drive?
1 terabyte.
Well, that's terrible.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a good size, but that's still for that kind of download for an older game on it on top of that?
Yeah.
Jeez,
178 man. Gigabytes. You might as well be getting a Nintendo Switch.
Yeah. Wow. That is
awesome. I just thought this was really cool because EA Access is something that I think is really worth it. It's $10 a month. You can play any of the games they have on EA Access, and if you buy any of those games, you get 30% off.
Okay, that is a really... Wait. I'm confused. So you get it, you can
It's
play.
A streaming service, just like PlayStation Now almost, but it's all just EA games. Yep, and
all their shooters, everything.
Every new game, like I'm sure Star Wars is going to be on there, every new game is up a week early on EA Access. So you get to play the game a whole week early if you're an EA Access member.
Why would you buy a game if you have this thing? Well, I'm saying.
They do it in case you just want to own it, I guess. They do rotate the games out, so I don't think that they all stay on there all the time. But I know Battlefield 1 was on there. The sports games go up on there. But I think it's just worth it if you think about it. You can just easily get a game. If you want to run a whole bunch of games on there, then you can get 30% off of Star Wars if you want.
Right.
But other than that, EA also recently added that it has no plans, as of right now, to bring any more games to the Nintendo Switch.
Big shock.
Yeah, they were asked, and they said that as of right now, they're in no rush to bring any more hardware. They're going to give Nintendo a year to see exactly where the demand is on the Switch, and to see how FIFA 18 does, because when they brought it originally out, it hasn't really been doing well. I'm sure it takes a lot of resources to really get a game on a Switch. Like, I hear that developing a game for the Switch is easy, but I'm sure when you have to develop a game for the PS4, or Xbox One, and the Switch, it might get a little more complicated.
We were talking about that earlier with the cartridges.
Yes.
You know, it being such a difficult thing. I'm not shocked to see that, you know what I mean? I mean, one game where they kind of, hands out. But it's not like they're saying they're completely done with it. It's, let's give it a year to see where we're at, so that makes sense.
Yeah. You know. And I think the Switch is still so new that it's hard to really know if a lot of the purchases people do is because of hype or if it's because people actually just want these games.
Or, you know, they're still actually playing it in a year.
Yeah.
You know, I played my Switch more than I played it in a really long time with Mario Odyssey. Loved every minute of it after I was done Mario Odyssey.
Now it's been sitting there again.
Yep, and got turned right back off.
Yeah.
And I'll probably pick it up on the 17th when Skyrim comes out. You know what I mean?
Yeah, my Switch is just still sitting there, and I have no plans of picking it up until December 2nd.
Xenoblade.
What
was it?
Xenoblade 2.
Xenoblade, that's
So speaking of Switch news, though, that's why I wanted to bring this up too. L.A. Noire. Let's talk about this news. So L.A. Noire download only is 29 gigabytes.
That's ridiculous.
So you can't even fit that on your Switch.
No.
If you just don't have any internal memory. But, you know, there's hope. There was a physical release, right? So you're like, oh, okay. Get it physically. I won't have any downloads. False. 14 gigabyte download. Even with the cartridge.
Why don't you sound like Dwight from The Office, too? This is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Why? And we were talking about, this is an older game, man.
Yeah.
And this really does, and we didn't get to finish the conversation because your phone got cut off yesterday, but this makes me worried about Skyrim.
Yeah.
You think that something like
Well, that's when I was saying, I kept saying this on the phone, I could hear you, but you couldn't hear me because of the patch of land I was driving through. But I kept saying Xenoblade is such a beautiful, large game. Like, there's no way that that game is going to just fit on just a cartridge without a download.
But I was looking at some of the SD cards pricing them out yesterday, and they're just ridiculously expensive. It's like, come on, Nintendo. Honestly, and I told my wife this, if you're making games that require these SD cards, they should be included with the game. Honestly, you know what I mean? You could do that with the GameCube. Remember that when Animal Crossing came with a memory card?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you do that?
I don't know. I mean, there are people on the internet that are really mad at, like, Rockstar. Like, they're kind of taking this out on the wrong people. They're like, oh, well, Rockstar could have just put it on a bigger cartridge. Because people are also mad that the game does cost more on the Switch than the PS4 and Xbox One. And it's like, well, you got that Switch tax, you know what I mean? It's not easy to bring a game over, and it's a cartridge that it has to go on.
It's not even just a cartridge. Look at the thing's tiny, man. Come on.
Yeah. So some people are mad, saying that's not fair. You know what I mean? And I get it, but I don't know, man. You hungry?
No.
You lying?
Maybe.
But yeah, I think it just looks bad. You know what I mean? Did Mario have a download?
No. No, and to me, it's unbelievable. Breath of the Wild, same thing.
Yeah, I don't remember Breath of the Wild either having a download.
You know, so I'm trying to figure out why. And Breath of the Wild was huge, man. It was huge. Not a lot of, you know what, though? Not a really breathing, living city like that, though. That does make the difference. A lot of people don't realize sometimes it's not about your scale, it's about your detail. That's
and
what makes up.
I've said that all the time about Breath of the Wild, and I know a lot of people attack me over it, but I just felt like the world never felt like it was alive.
Yeah, I can see it. I think they were kind of going with that. The game world wasn't supposed to be alive. Well, we were
turned down by Associate Professor. Even the minions, even the bad things that are walking around, they can't just be wandering and
see what you're saying. Point being, though,
I didn't know I was still in the world where NPCs walk a single path.
Point being, though,
you didn't have to kick.
L.A. Noire, like everything was going. You remember playing the game? I remember one of the best things about the game would I'd be driving to a case, there'd be a bank robbery. You know what I mean? A hold up, something where I pull over, put my lights on, you know, spin it around. Yeah. I remember my partner's like, I'm not going to another one of these. You know what I mean? Like, so maybe that would make the difference. But that's ridiculous. And it just makes me pissed because now I'm getting all the PS4. I was trying. I was talking myself into it every way.
I was getting all the PS4 anyway, but.
And now I'm legit worried about Skyrim. I really think. And what's funny is I watch a review on Skyrim. And they cut a lot of it out to make it run on the Switch.
Really?
Yes. Like, it's not much. Not, like, nothing out of the story or gameplay, but, like, less foliage or trees, vulture, stuff like that. Less, you know what I mean? Like,
so the forest isn't going to be as dense.
Yes, correct. You know what I mean? When you walk into a town, there might not be as many barrels or stuff like that. You know what I mean? And it's like, for me, that's cool because I never played the game, so I'm not going to miss it. You know what I mean? But for some reason, somebody went from playing, let's say, the PS4 version.
It's going to be looked at now as the lesser version.
Yep.
You know, especially when the game has crafting where you can build your own house and you can chop down trees for wood. It's like, all right, well, all the trees I needed were within 5 feet. How far do you have to travel?
Yeah. So now I did hear in the game one thing about the Switch version that's cool is it does load faster than the other versions.
Because it's probably cartridge.
Yeah, so that's interesting. But once again, though, it does make me worried that, okay, let's say Skyrim does need a cartridge. There's going to be a game eventually. So far, luckily, every game I wanted on the Switch hasn't needed one. But I'm worried that there's going to be the next one. You know, what happens when the Zelda collection comes out and I need SD card. You know what I mean? Or the release.
That's what you're worried. Yeah, and I get that worry too. Because don't get me wrong either, it's only 32 gigs. That's not a lot.
The re-release of Sunshine, if it ever does come out, you know. SD card required. Like, oh, come on.
Yeah.
So, hey, it is what it is. That's Nintendo.
But I did see a lot of people also saying they're not buying the game. They're like, oh, I was going to buy LA Noire on my Switch. I'm not going to buy this game at all because of them doing this. And it's like, what?
Oh, no, I'm so good. I love that game.
That makes no sense. Just because the game has a download or costs more on the system, why wouldn't you just buy it on another system? I get that you love your Switch, but it's like you don't have to get everything on it.
No, I agree with you. That's how people go crazy on those little little eShop games on there and go to town because they're trying to buy everything on the Switch. You don't have to. I agree.
Someone in this room did that for a little while. You must have learned your lesson.
Yes.
Was it Snake Pass? Was that the last straw?
No, it wasn't. It was a Genie Girl game that you actually
like. Oh, Half Genie Hero.
I was like, no, I'm done. I can't do
it. It's not too bad.
It's not too bad, but it's something I'll never finish. I got halfway through and I'm like, I'll never finish this again. Then I gotta pretend like I bought it for the kids, you know?
Like a lot of those download games you got, like that Zelda wannabe.
Yep, my Zelda waste of money, yep.
Yeah, I think the
Switch. Only one I've really, Mr. Shifty, I thought was a great choice on that.
Oh, Shifty!
Yeah, what was that, Shovel Knight, I really like Shovel Knight.
Shovel Knight's amazing, I do agree with that. But I don't like that the Switch doesn't have a traditional D-pad, so Shovel Knight's a no-go. But yeah, so do you think things like this are going to hurt the Switch more?
Absolutely, man. It doesn't, like I said, when your two competition are getting the game cheaper and easier to afford, it's like, it's what eventually hurt the Xbox One. Your competition says my software is easier to run on, it's more convenient, and you're not going to have as many problems. People look at that stuff, you know?
Or even pricing. Xbox One was $500, PS4 was $4.
Point being, though, if I go to my Switch and Sonic Forces is a prime example, I notice the quality drop in Sonic Forces to the PS4 version to the Switch, and it's like, now I gotta get it for the PS4.
And Sonic Forces isn't a very demanding game.
No. You know what I mean? Or, like, and it drives me crazy because then there's other games that, like, oh, it's not bad. I feel like Doom looks like a closer gap than Sonic Forces. So.
Yeah. But you know what? It could be two companies. Some companies might not want to put the time into it. They're just like, all right, bring it over to the Switch. We're not going to sit here and put too much extra time in.
Yeah. So the one I'm waiting for is to see how Skyrim runs on it, and then, you know, make a determination.
And see if Skyrim needs an SD card.
Yes. And then I'll go ahead and upload the footage and play it for the... Oh, wait. Nintendo won't let me do that.
Now, do you think it's kind of a slap in the face that Nintendo requires us to get these SD cards?
Yeah.
Because
it's a memory card in 2017 that they're required.
Yeah.
Okay, come on, man. When your competition has... What does the PS4 Pro come with for space size?
1 terabyte.
The PS4 Pro?
The PS4 Pro is a 1 terabyte hard drive.
Okay.
Yeah.
Xbox One, when you come with this measly internal memory, okay, fine. But then, at the end of the day, when you were first talking, because you got an SD card, I'm not saying when that came out.
For my Switch?
Yeah.
My Switch has an SD card for no reason. Because I literally have one game for it.
Yeah. You have Mario Kart too, didn't you?
That's all I have is Mario Kart. The only game I have for my Switch is Mario Kart.
Yeah, Legend of Zelda, too.
I got rid of Legend of Zelda. I got rid of Zelda, I got rid of Splatoon, I got rid of Mario Rabbids.
So anyway, point being, when literally we were talking about it and you were like, hey, I'm going to get an SD card. And I was like, nah, I probably won't ever need one. Why would I need one? Maybe if an eShop comes out. So I haven't even got an eShop. I haven't got a Nintendo shop where I can get Nintendo games. And already there's been two games. We're like, nah, it's required. So that's what's pissing me off. Like I said, it's my memory card in 2017.
I think what really sucks about it, too, is it turns a $60 game into almost $200.
My wife said that. She said that's ludicrous.
Yeah.
She's like, you know what I mean? To play one game, you would need this card. Because that's potentially what it is. Like, okay, in your mind.
And you're not going to buy a small one. Because why would you buy a 64 gig SD card? You're basically saying, okay, I can put maybe 5 or 6 more games on here. For what? To do it again? Buy another one?
Yep. Then you'd be like, really back in the day when you're switching out memory cards.
Yeah.
Like, okay. Did I have Tomb Raider on here?
I bought the 128 gig SD card for my Switch. And I did that because I knew, one, I wasn't going to buy too many games on my Switch. I really wanted to just be exclusives. Except even that's slim pickings for me, personally. And I just kind of... So I didn't think I needed anything super big. Because I do make 500 gig SD cards. And I heard that they're making 1 and 2 terabyte SD cards. Which are also super expensive. So I was like, you know what? 128 is good for me. But yeah, it just sucks, though. You know, that someone... Kids! A kid gets it. Like, what if a kid got a Switch for Christmas and was like, all right, I want to get this game. Oh, SD card required. I just got this system and this game, and I can't play it until I get an SD card.
Yep.
It's like when I got my PS2, and my mom didn't buy me a memory card.
Yep. Every Christmas, man, it was the worst day until you could go to the mall.
Yep. My mom got me a PS2 and Final Fantasy X. That system did not turn off until I got a memory card because I couldn't save in Final Fantasy. And I was like, I am not doing this all over again.
I remember I had Metal Gear Solid, and I started that game 3 times because I didn't have a memory card.
Jesus.
Yeah, I mean.
Okay. But that's pretty much it for the news. Was there anything else you wanted to add to this?
No.
No more to LA Noire or Nintendo scare?
I mean, I still love you, Nintendo. Don't take this personally.
He always will. You literally could release a turd with an N on it and he'd love it.
I love it.
I thought about making a drawing of the turd with Mario hat on it and a mustache like Mario threw the hat at a piece of shit and became it.
I would take that, man.
I think I'm going to do it. Draw some little steams coming off as if it's a hot steamer.
Hey, Mr. Hanky, that's all.
But, my enthusiast pick is actually going to be a movie.
I thought it was going to be some Japanese RPG from the PS2.
I realize I have to say a lot of those. You know what? Let's just stick with those.
Yeah, that's a matter of fact. As long as it's not an anime, is it?
No, it's not an anime, actually. The movie I was going to say, I really, for some odd reason, been thinking about Hellboy a lot lately. Hellboy 2. The Gorn Army.
Such a good movie.
That's my pick. You know what? I don't know why I've been thinking about him so much. Maybe because after I saw Stranger Things, and I know that the cop guy.
The new picture got released online with him in the trench coat, too.
Yeah. So I was really thinking about it, and I was just like, you know what? That was such a good movie.
You know, that is honestly, you could skip the first movie. Even though the first one's good.
The first one's good, but this one is.
That movie stands on
leagues better.
Own, yeah. And that's one of the things I appreciate about that sequel is it didn't play it safe. It didn't feel like the first one. That's literally its own movie. It starts off, it explains the Golden Army, and by the end of it, like, oh, such a fun movie, man.
Yeah.
And the villain, the prince in that is so badass. Honestly, like,
when he does all those flips and shit.
Like, oh, when he first comes to challenge his father, and the two guards swing the sword, and he's like, nope, I ran underneath.
Takes him all out on his own.
Oh, man, that's a great choice. And you know what's hilarious is they always have it at, like, 5 below and stuff like that on Blu-ray for $5.
Yeah.
It's easy to find that movie, so go find it, because it is amazing.
Yeah. Especially if you can get it for $5.
I think I own that one by itself. I don't know if I own the first one. I might own the first one.
I've always owned the second one, and I never bought the first one. It's kind of like me and Thor.
Well, like I said, I went and bought the second one when it came out, because I saw it in theaters.
I bought the one that came with the figure.
Yeah, and I seen it in theaters, and I remember after seeing it in theaters, just thinking of how amazing it was. I remember I got to the part, and it's not spoilish, but when him and Abe were singing, and I was like, I remember looking at the person I went with and going, this is one of the best movies I've seen my life. Like, it was so great. And then the movie only gets better from there because you get the final epic battle, and that's one of the best in movie history. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So, I really hope you guys watch it and enjoy it. But thanks for listening to this episode. If you liked it, hit that like button. And please, you know, share us around. We don't mind being passed around.
Nah, man. Like the town bicycle. Everybody can get a ride.
Yeah. You know, and we don't want to be like a moped. Mopeds are like fat girls. They're all fun until some of your friends see you on it.
Yeah.
We want to be the motorcycle.
Oh, man. So go ahead and like us, like you said, and hit us up on Twitter, Facebook, SoundCloud, Twitch, YouTube.
And our website.
And our website. And Jonathan, I know you're listening.
Jonathan Silver. You, sir, are not the moped.
Okay. Hit me up, man.
You might be the moped.
All right.
You might be the moped DM for Jonathan.
Me, bro. All right. You can personally email me, send me, you know, comment YouTube. I don't care anything. Just make it a code. Only me and you have to know what we're talking about. I love you and I miss you, sir.
You're going to get a message. You're my moped. The fat girl that you... Everyone has fun riding him until your friends catch you on it.
You know, you ever see... Remember that episode of X-Men Wolverine was looking at the picture of Jean Grey? I was doing that on my phone the other day of him. It's like, oh, there's me and you together, man. Me and you together. Too bad you had to ruin that picture by being in it, too.
Well, this has been episode 48 of The Enthusiast, and we are gone.
Peace.
Yes, good. Now you're getting it.